Welcome. My name is Christopher Herring. I'm the chairman of the Texas Association African American Chambers of Commerce. And today we are providing you with information regarding Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his economic bill of rights. Most people truly don't know that Dr. King in 1968 had an economic bill of rights. And some people think that because of those rights that he was asking for our nation to change how we do business, that many people just don't know that there was a threat that he had presented in terms of providing boycotts, doing business differently to get the attention of the nation when the nation wasn't really paying attention to the needs of African Americans or black people during that time. So we're going to talk to some very distinguished guests that came from a long way. Some are here local, but I wanted to be able to have this conversation about Dr. King's true dream, which was to create, in my opinion, an economic opportunity for all people to enjoy, and in particular, black businesses in America. And today we see that, and as our experts will confirm, we have a state of emergency still today with how we do business in America. So, before we get too serious, I would like to introduce our panelists, and then I'm also going to show you a very short clip of Dr. King and his words about why this situation of economic justice is so important. Okay, so I'm going to start from my left. We have Mr. Joseph Kinney. Joseph is the chairman of the Employment First SA. Now, what is that? Employment First SA is an advocacy group that really champions the rights for those individuals who have disability. When I was the Alamo City Chamber president, Joseph asked me to be his guest speaker. And I tell you, when I met the people in Exenon,
yes,
it was packed. And I saw so many different people of different diversity that were impacted. Joseph will tell you that he's a huge fan of Dr. King and Malcolm X.
Yes.
And he'll talk to you about how Dr. King's economic bill of rights impacts people with disabilities. So thank you for joining us today. Give him a hand. Next, I'll introduce India Woodington. India was an intern with the Alamo City Black Chamber of Commerce when I was the president. And she came into our organization and was just phenomenal, smart, always just on point. You know, any successful leader will tell you that to be successful, you have to have great people. Well, this was my great person who I really just believed in. She was a senior at UTSA. When she graduated, she was graduated magna cum laude because of her academic brilliance. But then I also found that she just had this this want to help energize her community. You can see she's a millennial. And I think that when we talk about Dr. King and the dream and this vision of economic justice, I really want to hear her voice as a millennial. It's important to engage this group in our conversation, because all too many times we see civil rights as being for old folks. But really, civil rights has to be for all, and we have to know how to incorporate this new mindset into our current movement. So India is currently the president of Future CEO. It's an organization and a business that was designed to help provide economic and financial literacy, workforce development, and she's doing a great job in her first year as that. So, welcome, India. And I might say she will hopefully soon get her acceptance letters to law school, and we'll be very proud to follow her in return. Okay, so next, I have to introduce a man who really I've learned so much from on a very personal level. He's the president of the Texas Association for African American Chambers. Mr. Charles O'Neill. Mr. O'Neill has really spent a lifetime laboring in terms of how do we get and to support black-owned businesses in our state of Texas. Not only that, he is on the board of directors for the United States Black Chambers, Inc., that's in Washington, D.C. He truly is a role model. He's phenomenal in what he does. He travels all throughout Texas, from El Paso to Houston to San Antonio to Corpus. He's all over the place, basically because he really fundamentally believes in the tenets of trying to recreate and provide us with an opportunity to do well in the marketplace. He's a man of sacrifice. He's my fraternity brother, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. And I just say he's a real brother who is really focused on how does he move this state organization to another level. I mean, in the state of Texas, we have 200,000 black-owned businesses. And Mr. O'Neill will share with us, in his words, on what we need to do to mobilize the dream and the vision of Dr. Martin Luther King. So welcome, Mr. Charles O'Neill. And next, I'll introduce an attorney, an esteemed attorney, Charlotte Key. Charlotte Key comes from Dallas. She has her law practice. She's been practicing law for a decade in the fields of business. And so I asked her the question. I said, Charlotte, I said, since you focus on business, business formations, and she understands the nature of black-owned businesses, can you please come down and impart some knowledge in terms of how do we take what Dr. King left us with, and how do we translate it so that more of our businesses can be successful? Charlotte is also the president of the Collin County Black Chamber of Commerce. And so she's really doing a lot of great work in Collin County to promote her black businesses that are there and to make sure that the county enjoys really a very diverse opportunity to do business with all people. So welcome, thank you for coming in from Dallas. All right, I'm gonna now play a very quick video so you can kind of be on the same page as these folks in terms of what did Dr. King say about America and what did he challenge our nation's leaders to do in regards to economic freedom.
We don't have to curse and go around acting bad with our words. We don't need any bricks and bottles. We don't need any Molotov cocktails. We just need to go around to these stores and to these massive industries in our country and say, God sent us by here to say to you that you're not treating his children right. And we come by here to ask you to make the first item on your agenda fair treatment where God's children are concerned. Now, if you're not prepared to do that, we do have an agenda that we must follow. And our agenda calls for withdrawing economic support from you. So as a result of this, we're asking you tonight to go out and tell your neighbors not to buy Coca-Cola in Memphis. Go by and tell them not to buy sealed test milk. Tell them not to buy what is all the bread, Wonder Bread. And what is on the bread from the dressing? Tell them not to buy hard bread. As Jesse Jackson has said, up to now, only the garbage men have been feeling pain. Now we must kind of redistribute the pain. We are are choosing these companies because they have been planning their hiring policies, and we are choosing them because they can begin the process of saying they're going to support the needs and the rights of these men who are on strike. And then they can move on town, downtown, and tell Mayor Lowe to do what is right. And not only that, we've got to strengthen black institutions. I call upon you to take your money out of the banks downtown and deposit your money in Crusade Bank. We want a bank-in movement in Memphis. Go by the Savings and Loan Association. I'm not asking you something that we don't do ourselves in SCLC. Judge Brooks and others will tell you that we have an account here in the Savings and Loan Association from the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. We are telling you to follow what we are doing. Put your money back. You have six or seven black insurance companies here in the city of Memphis. Take out your insurance now. We want to have an insurance in. Now, these are some practical things that we can do. We begin the process of building a great economic base. And at the same time, we are putting pressure where it really hurts. I ask you to follow through here. Now let me say, as I move to my conclusion, that we've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point in Memphis. We got to see it through. When we have our march, you need to be there. If it means leaving work, if it means leaving school, be there. Be concerned about your brother. You may not be on strap, but either we go up together or we go down together. Let us develop a kind of dangerous unselfishness.
Dangerous, unselfish.
I just wanted to welcome you here today. And, my name is Jonathan Quash. I'm the director. Okay.
How many of you have saw that video before today? Okay, so some of you haven't seen the video, right? And the reason why I wanted to show that video is because oftentimes you'll see the I Have a Dream speech. And you're very familiar with that speech. And that's a speech that's been very widely adopted as being the preferred voice of Dr. King that we've heard. And so now I want to sit down, I'm going to talk to these experts and let them share with you really what was Dr. King talking about. Because to me, this is really the central part of his life and the legacy that he left behind that we actually can do some things. I'm going to open it up with Mr. Charles O'Neill. So when you think about that speech, what comes to mind in terms of the sacrifice that Dr. King was talking about? Is there still this need, and are we sacrificing to stick together as brothers, as he had mentioned?
First thing I thought about listening to that clip is that's what got him killed. It was such a departure seemed to be such a departure from the message that, again, the comfortable message folk had allowed to arise around Dr. King and what his message was reported to be. And so it was almost like it was a departure from, it was not necessarily, but it was something of a departure from what folk had become comfortable knowing about Dr. King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and their approach to achieving racial justice in America. I just for the first time, I did some remarks to a group back in November, and I stated to them that for the first time publicly, I admitted that I was one of the last people to come around to Dr. King's approach to achieving racial justice. I was more drawn to Stokely Carmichael, Rap Brown, and of course, Eldridge Cleaver, Malcolm X, because it was, again, apparently, it appeared to be a more immediate resolution to this seemingly intractable problem of race in America. But I want to just real quickly, for those of you who were not familiar, and I was not totally comfortable, but Martin Luther King Jr.'s Bill of Economic and Social Rights says the right of every employable citizen to a decent job, the right of every citizen to a minimum income, the right of a decent house and the free choice of neighborhood, the right to an adequate education, the right to participate in the decision-making process, and the right to the full benefits of modern science in healthcare. Pretty comprehensive. And you could almost say, well, we've got all those things now. We can get a good education, we can live where we want to live, we can get a job. So why is there still this big, big gap in what we feel is equal access? And so what Mr. Wyatt and I, and you now, Chris, in your role as chair of our organization, we're pretty comfortable saying, well, clearly we've got lots of work left to do. Texas is I like to think of Texas as ground zero for how we might wage the battle for a couple of reasons. One, primary is this tremendous demographic shift. And with in-migration of populations to Texas is not just Hispanics. And by the next census, Texas will have the second largest black population among the 50 states. You've heard Chris talk about the 200,000 plus black-owned businesses in the state. And with a little known factoid about the Texas economy is black-owned businesses have led the nation in the rate of business formation for two decades. Right here in the state of Texas, you would not know that unless you were digging down through economic data. At the same time, this tremendous growth in the rate of business formation, we've seen this stagnation or flatline of earning. So a lot more people busy about the business of business, but they're not earning. If they're not earning, the businesses aren't growing, that means that you've got a problem pop out there called underemployment. If their businesses aren't growing, they can't hire people, they won't expand their businesses and make bigger contributions to the economy. And so, all of that, and I don't want to hog all the time, Chris, but very clearly, we have not achieved, ultimately, what Dr. King set forth, frighteningly now, nearly 50 years ago. And so, it is heartening to have our millennial colleague with us and a whole bunch of folk in between my age and and hers. So we'll probably get to a good answer here today. But I think that one, thank you all for being here and for sharing in this with us. I think that every opportunity that we get to engage with the public, we add something to our arsenal, and we'll learn to attack this problem in new and expanded ways. And so, I take every opportunity like this as a dialogue. And so I want to hear as well from you about how we might better get to where Dr. King was headed.
I appreciate you making those points. I also know that when we looked at that Economic and Social Bill of Rights that I asked you all to look at, I know that there was also a component of that which talked about persons with disabilities, which is probably even lesser known. So Joseph, tell us a little bit about what you do, but also relate it to what Dr. King was talking about in his Bill of Rights.
What we do with the Employment for San Antonio, first, it is a national movement with the premise that all individuals, regardless of their level of disability, are capable of working competitively and finding meaningful employment. The first thing, watching the video, and some of the very first words that Dr. King's mouth, is he said, God's people are coming. And I was raised in the church, and one of the very first things that I was taught is God don't like ugly. And that folks with disabilities, like children, and not comparing them to children, but like children, those are God's people. And you do right, like Dr. King said, do right by God's people. And I think that when we look here in America, we've overcome a lot of the isms, sexism, ageism, racism, and we've still got ways to go in those things, but there's an invisible population out there of folks that, before my time, they were just locked away in institutions. Now, these folks are saying, hey, we're here, and we have the same wants and the same needs as everyone else, and we're also capable and qualified to participate in society. And when I think about Dr. King, I think about, especially now, as black folks, and we can be honest about this, we see a lot of groups co-opting Dr. King's message. Mm-hmm. Because who better to align yourself with than Dr. Martin Luther King? Now, I'm gonna be honest, like Christopher said, I came up in the generation, the hip-hop generation. My heroes were Chuck D, Tupac, Brother Malcolm. And we didn't always, we kind of looked at Dr. King as, Dr. King is soft. And then as you do that research and as you look, and as one of my favorite rappers, as Nas said, we didn't know how strong he was. And then we see the videos, like the one that Christopher presented, where you look at that and it's like, is that Brother Malcolm or is that Dr. King? And then you start to realize that those messages weren't so different. And basically what I'm trying to say is we have failed folks that are in the disabled community. And we have an opportunity now to look at employers and also look at the service providers and say, you know what, these folks are capable, these folks are qualified, and we've got to do better in providing real opportunities for these individuals to be a part of society, just like everyone else. Like I said, a lot of groups co-opt Dr. King, and as black folks, we kind of, sometimes we cringe. Let's just be honest, we cringe, and, I'm not sure, Dr. King is down for this. Economic rights for folks with disabilities, the ability to find meaningful and gainful employment and be somebody, I think is something that Dr. King would wholeheartedly be behind. And if he were alive today, I think that this would be one movement that he would actually be on the forefront with and actually align with versus a lot of the other things that we see. We know as Black for Loom, this is something that he would get behind. So I just dare everyone today to just look out and think about all those times where you think there might be a liability issue if you're a business owner. I've got a stack of numbers right here that I can show you. Liability issues, most folks with disabilities, actually the numbers prove that there are less accidents on the job. You have less turnover in your workforce amongst your folks that are disabled that are coming to work. They appreciate the opportunity and they're there to help individuals' bottom lines to make that money, and they're fully capable. It's just give them opportunity, and that's what they're looking for. So I definitely think that this fall right around the back.
Well, that's why I invited, because I know that when we talk about the unemployment rate for those individuals with disability, it's almost one out of four.
About one out of four, yes.
So it's about 25% unemployment.
Actually a little bit more than that. I think it's about 34%.
Right. And when I look at Black families, Hispanic families, all families, you start to look at the family unit, you see that we have individuals who we're caring for, who we're loving for, but yet they need that opportunity to be able to have some form of meaningful income that will support that family. Am I right? So a lot of times we also see that those individuals with disabilities will have to revert, and they will have to create their own businesses to be able to earn an income of some type. And we'll get back to that. So now that I'm looking at India, I'm thinking about, so India, there's, for me, I've noticed that there's a gap between what Dr. King was saying then and what we hear today. Young people today, in my opinion, don't necessarily have the same appreciation for Dr. King or for those individuals who, fought, bled, died, and so forth. So tell us about, where am I wrong in my assumption? Because I know I'm wrong, but where am I wrong? And then how can we better structure our organizations, perhaps, so that we actually can be more attuned with the millennials and this generation that maybe we just don't know how to talk in that language?
Okay. Now that's a very interesting statement. I wouldn't say you're completely wrong about the notion that millennials don't have the type of respect that other generations have held for him. As I mentioned to Ms. Key earlier, growing up, we learned things in parts going through school. We learned these are the important civil rights leaders. We probably know two or three. Four, if you get very lucky or raised in a family that preaches these things. But if you go to a regular public school in Iowa or Texas or California, anywhere, you learn a couple of them. So we don't understand. And we were also raised in a time where we got to go to school with people of different races, of different beliefs. So it's not as bad of a situation. It's not as visible to us. So we don't understand the previous struggle, but we were also a generation that was raised in the thick of the technological revolution. So everything's just moving so fast now. We have to learn things that happened today and forecast what's going to happen for the next 50 years. That's a responsibility that we have, because we're just now learning the boundaries and the powers of technology. So it's also our responsibility, I believe, to go back and learn about this history and really understand the powers of Dr. King and Malcolm X and Dr. Carver, all of these wonderful leaders that have been lost to us, because, again, these are three important leaders, because you only have a semester, and it's not happening in our time. We don't have marches. We could. If Dr. King had Uber and Twitter, then it would be a lot but we're not utilizing the resources in ways that would have been utilized in the past. We're using them for things to check a music blog or to check the scores. I know I do, but there are other ways for us to utilize these tools. And I think it's important that we have people in my generation coming with leaders of other generations to understand this is what we need. We need the leaders. leaders like Mr. O'Neill, Mr. Wyatt, everyone here, to engage our community and our demographic and let us know these are the struggles that we went through and this is how it's relevant to your future, how it's relevant to you now. So we just have to do a better job of engaging and utilizing the tools that we have.
You said a lot there, and what I particularly like is that we were here at Cafe Commerce, and I'd like to thank Cafe Commerce for allowing us to use this this beautiful location. This was one of the locations in which the city had set aside to enable the city residents to be able to create businesses and to have resources. It's like a one-stop shop. And so they provided us with Dream Week, this venue. I also like to thank Nowcast SA for coming out and actually providing us with the video coverage so that other people who weren't able to make it today can hear a little bit about Dr. King and this economic and social Bill of Rights. And then also to our interpreters who are from the San Antonio College, we'd just like to thank them also for their ability to tie into today's program. Again, you know, when I'm thinking about this conversation, and we're going to give you the chance to ask your questions as well, so start thinking of it. But as I'm thinking about this, I know that there are many disparities between, you know, what white businesses look like and what black businesses look like. Oftentimes, and you know, I retired from the United States Air Force and I came out into this chamber business, and the Air Force is known as being pretty much a melting pot, right? So my peers would say, man, Chris, why did you get involved with that black chamber? I mean, that's separate. That's not what we did when we were on active duty. And then I say, separate, but there's a need. And there's a need that maybe the folks on the mainstream would never ever come across because they don't look like me, they don't have the same challenges that I have. When I took off my uniform, I had, you know, different challenges. When I had my uniform on, maybe for the most part, people gave me the benefit of the doubt that I was an American. Think about that. Outside of uniform, I'm just like any other black male in America. So I looked at, you know, coming into business myself. I had a business, but then I started looking at the statistics. I started looking at, you know, why are black businesses not as strong as white firms? So we have Attorney Key. Talk to us today about, you know, some of the legal implications of Dr. King's message. What would Dr. King say to black chambers and to attorneys in terms of his vision of the insurance and the sit-in type of mentality that he had? What would he say to us, Charlie?
I think one of the biggest issues that black businesses face today, and really many businesses, is access to information and access to capital. I believe the statistics 8 out of 10 small businesses fail within 18 months, and a big reason for that is because of access to capital, right? Are we going out there and are we supporting our black businesses as a community as well? We just finished with the Christmas and the holiday season, right? We spent all of these monies at big retailers, Walmarts and Targets and the Macy's, but how many of us actually went out and spent some of those dollars at black businesses, right? That's capital. And if we think about some of the economic principles in Dr. King's Bill of Economic and Social Justice, one of them is to be able to employ everybody that can go out and work, right? So if you think about how many black businesses do we have in the U.S., about 200,000, you said?
Oh, it's the state of Texas, 200,000 plus.
So 200,000 plus in the state of Texas, right? So imagine if those 200,000 businesses had enough capital to where they could hire 5 right? That would create a huge amount of jobs just here in Texas. So imagine if that spread across the country. And so although we've seen great growth in jobs under the current leadership of President Obama, I mean, there are still a lot of people that are unemployed, that are looking for work. And so we have to think about where we're spending our dollars, right? Also getting information out there as well. Like, a lot of companies, they may not know how to start their business, where to go to get funding. And that's something that the chambers have to focus on. We have to be able to provide that information to the communities, because that's the purpose of the chambers. The Black Chambers is to help support our Black businesses. So it's our job with the chambers to make sure that our communities are informed, that they know about crowdfunding and what it is and what the regulations are behind that, that they know about other funding sources besides your traditional banks that are out there, because there are a lot of other funding sources, non-traditional sources, that businesses can go to get capital other than just going to your big box banks, your Bank of America's, your Chase's, things like that. So as chambers, we have to make sure that we're letting the community know about these things, that we put on programs, that we focus on these things. And as citizens in our communities, we have to make sure that we support the businesses that are out there, right? Don't be so quick to go to Walmart. I know, I go all the time, they have everything, right? You can get everything that you need in one place. But there are a lot of businesses out there. I have a law school colleague who just recently started an online database of Black businesses called our Power Box, right? So you can go onto that website, and it's a directory of Black businesses all across the United States. So there are other places out there. There are other places that we can spend our dollars that will not only help Black businesses with capital, but also give them opportunity to create jobs as well.
Well, thank you for that. You know, when you were talking about the national picture, I was actually thinking about when Charles and let me acknowledge Mr. Jim Wyatt. Mr. Jim Wyatt was the past chairman of the Texas Association for African American Chambers. He has really carried Black businesses on his back over the years because he has such a passion for really, you know, being committed. And I think that was another word that Dr. King used to say, is be committed to whatever you do. And then I'd like to recognize Ms. Renee Watson. Ms. Watson, as you may know, actually puts on Bexar County's small minority women and veteran-owned conference every year. And she packs the house over at the Freeman. She does such a great job to make sure that we all are informed and we have the right tools. So I'd just like to recognize both of you right now. Thank you for both being here. But to go back to my panelists, yeah. Mr. O'Neill, we had a conversation with Governor Abbott. And when we thought about some of the things that have happened in our nation, the Fergusons that have erupted, I can recall Governor alluding to the fact that in his heart, he would never want to see a Ferguson type of an environment be here in the state of Texas. What does Governor Abbott need to know about Dr. King's message that would help to enable him to see that when we look at the San Antonios, the Austins, the Dallases, the Houstons, and those large Black concentrations of people, what does the governor need to know today about the need to support those communities in a different way?
I was thinking, as I listened to everybody's response, that one of the most critical shortfalls is reliable information, critical communications. And I think my background, of course, is in the newspaper business. I published the weekly newspaper for 10 years, ran other folks' newspapers for about 10 years before that. And I've watched as we have, and it sounds ominous, but it really is, as we've all become held sway to a particular way of talking about things, or illustrating things, or describing only two or three valiant souls striving for civil rights, rather than this entire phalanx of folk who gave their lives literally. And so I can speak particularly from black community's perspective when Texas was one of those really cuckoo states, and it's holding fast to its reputation, that literally outlawed the presence of the Chicago Defender in the state. And so Pullman porters used to smuggle black newspapers in from other states and drop them off, Longview, Tyler, San Antonio, Houston, so that folk could get the word. And so now, and I'm putting all this against what I witnessed last night, trying my best to stay focused on the reality show that is Republican debate. How folks have their opinions about what's really going on in the marketplace shaped by folk who present the news to you. And so Governor Abbott needs to know that Texas is not what he has been told it is. Texas is very much a dynamic marketplace that is made up of black folk and brown folk and disabled folk and everybody else that have needs that are being unmet by the government that he is charged responsible for leading. He said, as you mentioned, Chris, that one of the things he was most concerned about is not having another Ferguson erupt in Texas. I thought more telling was the statement he made to us a little bit before that, was when we laid out our case for why it was imperative that his government be more responsive to the needs of black-owned businesses, that he says, I really want to be helpful to you, but I don't know what your businesses do. And it's 2015 at that time. The leader of the largest economy among the 50 states doesn't know what 200 plus thousand business owners contribute to his state's economy. Well, that's crazy. And so I think until we begin to peel back the onion, so to speak, and reorient ourselves toward what is really happening, what is the reality of our existence, and not rely on someone else's painting of a picture for you, I think each of you sitting here today will know that the life you lead is very much different than the life that is described as being emblematic of living in San Antonio, Texas, for instance. And so we missed that when we had good reporting about what our lives are. And so now we've got this homogenous thing that goes out, and I caution folk all the time that diversity and diversion have the same root word. I'm a word person, and so I study stupid stuff like that, right? But you can get thrown off track just by a semantic trick. And so we gotta be very, very careful about what we allow to get into our consciousness, because we begin trying to live something that's really reflective of reality. And so that's maybe a little far-fetched from where your question was directed me, Chris, but I think that good, accurate information allows us to reach the kinds of real answers that we need to get. And in the case of our state, when folk like yourselves learn that a state can spend $16 billion in goods and services and have 10% of its business infrastructure be black-owned businesses, yet manage to spend only 1.25% of that $16 billion with black-owned businesses, you scratch your head and say, how is that possible? You cannot, in my words, you can't spend 1% unless you're trying to spend 1%. you can accidentally spend more than that, you know, and until all of us know how our money flies out our pockets, we're not even trying to spend money.
And I spend that much money today, man.
And so our state, who we have given over charge for how they administer our tax investment in our state, And they said, well, thank you for your money, but you're not getting anything back. And so, in a sense, we become irresponsible when we don't raise that issue to our elected officials and say, hey man, what's up with that? You know, and so again, far range and wide range, and I don't know if I hit all the buttons, but I'm trying to hit them all. I'm gonna be like Donald Trump. We can grab a lot of things. I do a lot of things. We do great things.
Listen, ladies and gentlemen, after going along with your questions, just please raise your hands and I'll come by to acknowledge you. But I think it's important that, yes, the information in which we receive sometimes is hitting bullseye, and then sometimes it's way off. Yeah. And the ability to be able to discern the difference between the two is sometimes even just as difficult of a task, because we sometimes believe in the people who take the microphone and who really control the airwaves. I think, and again, I went back to the whole notion of the dream. Everybody in this room has seen Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech, right? Yes?
Yes.
Right.
Yes. All right. So, again, the speech that we showed you was a speech in which happened in 1968, the year of his assassination. And that's why you always have to, you know, go back to what Mr. O'Neill said. You have to pause and really think about why was he assassinated? You know, was it just his protest of Vietnam? No, it was more or less it was a protest of the economic system. So it was made mention that President Obama, you know, has made some cool advances. You know, let me go back down to the end to Joseph. What are some of the things that you've seen in the President Obama time that you think has helped the cause, the struggle that you spoke of earlier?
Well, just speaking in terms of disability employment and access to correct training and the ability to obtain and maintain employment is the Employment First movement. It's a national movement. One of the things under President Obama, he signed in, it's the Work Incentives Opportunities Act. And one of the things that WIOA did was that it advocated and also its mandates upon the states to have those agencies that are working with folks with disabilities go out and make connections in the local communities with local school districts, with businesses, with other agencies that are providing services for vocational rehabilitation to folks with disabilities through the Employment First movement. That's where our organization, Employment First San Antonio, actually grew.
Has the president done a good job by you?
I think, like everyone here, you know, speaking as an African American, I think that we feel. Yes, but he could do more. He could have done more.
In what areas do you think that he could have done
more? Well, I think, just speaking for folks with disabilities and, you know, and that employment piece, I think that being more vocal and really, they didn't, you know, talk about information. As the president, you have a platform. And to be honest and give good, correct information. You know, let business owners know, let lending institutions know about the qualifications of individuals with disabilities, qualifications of disabled veterans. Let these folks know that you have an entire population of people with incredible purchasing power out there that you are ignoring. And not only are you ignoring them, when they're asking for assistance so they can become entrepreneurs themselves, you're ignoring that aspect of what they bring to the table. So you've got a whole group of people with all types of talent that we have just basically set on the shelf. And we're not bringing attention to that talent pool. So that's one thing I kind of think we need to
I feel like, you know, he ain't sitting in class and the teacher asks questions, say, ooh. just real quick, I just thought of this. If we remove partisanship, you know, Republican, Democrat, whatever, away from it, and we remove all other whatever we might think about President Obama, and get to a group that said, at his prior to his inauguration, anything he tries to do, we're gonna block it. Mm-hmm. Anything he tries to do, we're gonna say no. Further, we're gonna sit in the halls of our United States Congress and call him a liar in the State of the Union address. What would the expectation of a population be of his ability to execute his job? I would say that against that backdrop, whatever has been accomplished through this administration would put him up on Mount Rushmore. Because they were trying to get everything blocked to have achieved anything. Anything. Because they said, whatever he tries to do, we're going to say no. So to have achieved waking up tomorrow was an accomplishment for him. Now, that's different from what you hear in the press, right?
Yes.
Because he's incompetent, and he doesn't know what he's doing, and blah, 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 and he's probably, and I'm biased, the smartest man to ever have been the president of the United States. Okay? And I mean, you'll use whatever measure y'all want to use. The man is brilliant.
Yes.
Again, as ever, now, I'm going to be finished. This will be my last one. You saw what Martin King said. They got him killed.
Yes.
President Obama is still alive. And he has said virtually the same thing that he said. So he's pretty good in my book. I'm sorry.
Okay. Charlotte.
I'm sorry.
You know, in the state of Texas, Governor Abbott has basically said that he is getting behind the notion that this is the time for women-owned businesses to lead the nation. And so he's actually stated, you can go to the website for the governor, that he fully backs women-owned businesses. What are you seeing from women-owned businesses and black women-owned businesses in particular to that vision that Governor Abbott has placed out there?
Well, black female-owned businesses is the fastest growing and leading small business creation, right? I believe black female businesses have grown 322% since 1997. And currently, 14% of all women-owned businesses are owned by black females, and I am a black female business owner myself. So I see that black women are going out there. We're taking advantage of access. We're taking advantage of the opportunity to create our own way. I had a partner tell me one time that the only way to sustain yourself really is to have your own book of business, to have your own company, right? If you apply that to everyone else, because, you know, we see layoffs, we see unemployment, we see people that can't find jobs, but you can go out there and create your own opportunities, and I think black women are really taking advantage of that. And I know President Obama and his administration have recently just created a grant of about $118 million to focus on job training for black women and young children, right? To get them job training, to get them skills, and to put programs in place to help with that. So black women are taking advantage of the opportunities, and we need to see other not just black women, but you know, women in general take advantage of the opportunities that are out there.
You know, we are seeing a tremendous growth, and I think, you know, whenever I hear that conversation about black female businesses and our black business community, sometimes we have a splintered conversation.
And again, I'm a family type of guy. I go back to one family. And so do you think that in terms of black business and the growth of black business, that it's actually moving forward in a positive direction? Or, you know, as a new chamber president, what are some of the goals that you have for the black businesses in your community?
One of the big things that I want to promote is support each other. Just as we saw in the video of Dr. King, right? You have to help your brother, right? Because if we all work together, then we achieve more. And I see a lot where someone will be successful, make it, and their business is thriving, but they don't go back and teach other women who are trying to do the same thing how to be successful as well. So I think support is a big issue that we have to work on in our community, make sure that we are giving access to everyone that needs it. And that's something that I want to promote in the chamber, right? I'm creating that community feeling, right? When Dr. King was here, we all worked together as a community, right? It was the community that rallied and did the Montgomery boycott, right? It was the community that did all of these marches, right? And so we need to get back to that strong sense of community and supporting each other.
So, India, how do I rally the millennials?
We've really started to kind of segment ourselves. And now another thing we have, an issue we have, is our leadership. We look up to LeBron James or, like when you said King yesterday, that's kind of what clicks. You think King, or you think a rapper, or you think something of that nature. We don't have a Dr. King right now. We have a President Obama, which is wonderful, because it is very important that we have this representation, which is why that election was such a big thing, and now Hillary Clinton's campaign is important, because we have a woman being represented. So it is important to have that strong leadership, because we look and we have one of 44 presidents, we have one black person. Not one black person, not just one. So it's a little difficult for us to look and say, oh, we want to aspire to be that. And how many, I don't know many people who say, oh, I aspire to be the next Martin Luther King. But I do hear, oh, I want to be the next Steph Curry. So how do we translate their leadership, which is trailblazing in its own way, but to do something that's for the community, cultivating that community feeling, as you mentioned, and really engaging and showing that there are multiple facets to our community than just the glitz and the glamour, which is something we're pretty pushed for.